Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. V. Selvakumar, Assistant Professor in the Department of Epigraphy and Archaeology, Tamil University, Thanjavur. Under the Indian culture subject, we have the paper of Prehistoric and Protohistoric Cultures of India. Under this particular paper, we are going to deal with the skeletal biology of prehistoric populations in India. This module was written by Dr. Veena Mushri Tripathi, a paleoanthropologist at Deccan College, Pune. This module deals with the prehistoric skeletal biology of the populations of India. It concerns with the study of human bones. We aim to understand how the study of human bones can help us in understanding our past. Normally, you will think when we deal with the past or the study of history, only the written documents and archaeological objects are the evidence. Actually, our body itself is an important evidence for reconstructing history. The very shape of our bones, the very DNA in our body carries lot of historical information. Anthropology is such an important and interesting field that deals with the science of humans. Okay, let's see what is the meaning of the term anthropology. Anthropology has been coined from the two Greek word anthropos, which means man, or more appropriately human, and logi, which stands for the science of humans. It involves the study of human species at any place on the earth at any given time. There are anthropologists who study fossils to solve the riddles of human evolution, whereas there are others who try to understand the effect of modernization on contemporary society. While subjects like economics and biology focus on specific aspects of human life, anthropology is the only discipline that addresses all facets of human existence. In short, anthropology is a holistic study of human beings, both biological as well as cultural aspects. Anthropology has several divisions. One of them is physical anthropology or biological anthropology. This branch of anthropology actually studies the human bones and human evolution, how humans have physically evolved from the earlier species. It deals with the tracing the biological origins, evolutionary changes, and the genetic diversity of the human species. In the process, biological anthropologists study primate behavior and anatomical variations between primates and human beings in order to understand physical changes that have taken place in humans during their evolutionary journey from apes. They may also take up genetic analysis and anthropometric studies to find reasons behind the physical differences between people of various groups. The next division of anthropology is cultural anthropology. Cultural anthropology is a complex whole of knowledge, morals, traditions, arts, and customs that we have learned as being part of a society. It is transferred over generation non-biologically through words and symbols. Cultural anthropologists try to understand the logic behind cultural norms. They believe that no tradition or cultural practice is wrong. During their research, cultural anthropologists live within a community, observe their customs, and try to understand them in comparison to the practices of other societies. Cultural anthropologists may study a society living on the far end of the globe. Thus, cultural anthropology focuses on human cultures and its manifestations. Archaeology is another important branch of anthropology. Archaeology deals with studying the tangible remains of a culture. Fortunately, human beings leave clues about their ways of life, not only in words and alphabet, but also in the form of material remains like potsherds, foundation of houses, stone tools, and burials. These reveal important information about the beliefs, traditions of a particular civilization or community. Study of burial sites can help archaeologists understand the religious beliefs of a group of people. Ethnoarchaeology is used for archaeological interpretation. Another branch of anthropology is linguistic anthropology. Language is an important agent of transmission of culture. In the endeavor to understand the origin and evolution of a language and oral traditions, linguistic anthropologists gain valuable insights into the culture of a community. They understand the prehistoric links between various societies and explore the meaning of verbal concepts to learn about the conditions that existed in the past and how humans adjusted to those. Besides studying language from a cultural perspective, linguistic anthropologists also try to understand the biological implications of language. This involves studying changes in the human brain and body that enabled us to organize sounds in a meaningful way to evolve language. Now let us look at the evidence of human burials from the protohistoric India. The Indian subcontinent provides excellent array of human skeletal evidence representing a wide temporal span of the last 20,000 years and belonging to various cultural phases. Burying the dead human ceremonially indicates a complex cultural system of death rites. Because of the custom of disposing the dead within the habitational area, especially during the Neolithic Chalcolithic phases, human burials constitute one of the main evidences to be encountered in excavation. The study of burial practices and associated artifacts form an important aspect in the lifeway reconstruction of ancient population. Because of the fragmentary nature of the skeletal evidence, special care is required during its excavation and also cleaning and restoration of these elements. The main contributors of Indian anthropological studies are many. Some of the important scholars are Professor Airavathi Karve, Professor K. R. Kennedy, Professor John Lucas, and Professor S. R. Walimbe. These scholars have published several articles and books. By looking at these books and articles, you can gain better understanding of Indian skeletal materials. Now, we can look at the Indian skeletal materials from different contexts of India. They can be classified into four major categories. We have skeletal materials from hunting-gathering or Mesolithic population, Bronze Age Harappan urban dwellers, mainly the Indus Valley cultures, and then early agropastoral Neolithic Chalcolithic populations, and then we have evidence from Iron Age megalithic builders. These sites are distributed all across India. Now, as you see in this map, you can see these different kinds of evidence coming from different parts of India and also in Sri Lanka. What is the earliest date for the skeletal material from India? We have the earliest skeletal materials coming from the late Pleistocene context in India. But we have interesting collection of materials coming from Sri Lanka. From an upper Paleolithic context, roughly datable between 40,000 to 10,000 years before present. They are found in several caves of Sri Lanka. One of the important cave is Phagian cave. It is called as Phagian cave, and the finding here dates back to 30,000 years before present. At this site, they have found evidence of composite tools as specialist hunting aids, and in addition to that, they have also found continuity from the Mesolithic to the Neolithic Chalcolithic levels. Then coming to India, we have an important find at the site of Hathnora near the Narmada Valley, and this particular specimen is called Narmada Man. It was found at the site of Hathnora by Arun Sonakia. It is dated between 1.5 lakh to 40,000 years before. Apart from this, no other significant human ancestor findings have been found in India. In addition to that, several human bones have been found in varied contexts in India, but they are not very significant. The next set of skeletal materials come from the Mesolithic context in India. From the Mesolithic times onwards, we have better representation of human skeletal materials. The hunting-gathering or the Mesolithic period is generally placed between 10,000 to 2500 BC. Best excavated sites from the Gangetic Basin have produced several important skeletal materials. The main subsistence strategy during this period was hunting-gathering. The late Mesolithic population probably experimented farming. And in addition to that, domestication of cattle and sheep goat was also practiced during this period. The evidence for this is found at Bagor in Rajasthan. The important sites where human skeletal materials found are Batadamba Lena, Beli Lena, Belan Pandi Plaza in Sri Lanka. In India, Sarai Nahar Rai, Mahadaga, Damdama, Bimbetka, Bagor, Langnauj are the important sites that have produced evidence for human skeletal remains from the Mesolithic context. What you see here in this picture is the view of Beli Lena complex in Sri Lanka. Such caves were inhabited by the Mesolithic population, and we find interesting evidence comprising tools as well as skeletal materials in such caves. Next cultural stage is the Neolithic. Mainly people produced agro-pastoralism, that means primitive agriculture as well as sheep, goat and cattle rearing, and this phase is called otherwise Neolithic. And the next phase is Chalcolithic or Chalcolithic, when people started making copper implement. The earliest evidence for agriculture is found in India or the Indian subcontinent at Mehrgarh, which is now in Pakistan. And intensive evidence for domestication of animals and plants is found all across India, and generally the evidence continues up to 4000 years BP. Many of these sites are mainly rural settlements. People generally had a kind of rural culture. Small-scale trade also happened among these cultures. Especially in the northwestern part of India, we have some evidence for the initiation of urbanization processes in the Neolithic period. The Neolithic culture in India had coexistence with the Mesolithic population. We have evidence for habitation, cum burial sites spread all over, and better they are known from the peninsular region of in India. In the skeletons, there is over-representation of sub-adults. The important sites of the Neolithic Chalcolithic context are Inamgan, Nevasa, Daimabad, Balathal, Bursahom, and Ramapuram. These are the important sites that have produced skeletal remains. What you see here in the image is an unexposed twin urn burial from the Chalcolithic site of Inamgan in Maharashtra. These are some of the earliest burial practices undertaken by the people. Interestingly, these burials are important because we find lot of skeletal materials, and these skeletal materials throw a lot of light on the way of life of the people as well as their physical characteristics. This is a twin burial from Inamgan. Sometime they have buried two individuals together. We don't know the significance of it. Because of some reason or other, the two people were buried together. And then we have another evidence for goat sacrifice at the site of Inamgan, which is also very significant. This tells us about the beliefs of the ancient people. And also we have evidence for multiple individuals buried within the same burial pit at the site of Inamgan. These kind of skeletal remains tell us a lot about the people and their ways of life. The next cultural phase is Bronze Age or Harappan urban civilization. We find a lot of evidence of these urban dwellers and their way of life from their burials. The Harappan urban dwellers had a very highly developed socio-political organization. It was a religious society. They depended upon farming and domestication also they had adopted, and their society was highly urbanized and self-sufficient and well-ordered. They had well-planned cities with public buildings, fortification walls, granaries, and we also have evidence for standardization of weights and measures. The cities supported huge population that adopted a variety of occupations. We also have evidence of coexistence of Mesolithic, Neolithic, Chalcolithic population in this cultural context. Large skeletal series relatively better preserved are found at these sites. Anthropological studies have mainly confined to morphometric analysis. There is much more analysis we can undertake to better unravel the information hidden in these skeletons. The important sites that have produced skeletal materials from the Harappan context are Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, Lothal, Kalibangan, Rakigari, and Senoli. What you see in this image is an extended adult burial excavated at the site of Harappa. It is a very interesting burial where we find complete skeletal remains. The next important context in India where we have skeletal materials are from the Megalithic or Iron Age burial context. The Megalithic or Iron Age culture is generally dated between 1000 BC to 100 BC. Sometimes we do have evidence for the Megalithic burials continuing even after 100 BC. There is also evidence for some of the burials existing even before 1000 BC. The Megalithic burial monuments were erected for the dead. And this particular society, when iron was in their regular implement, they were practicing the Megalithic burials. They buried the dead in various monuments. The monuments were built of stone, and also sometimes they used pottery materials such as urns and sarcophagus. We have several burial types such as cairns, stone circles, dolmens, dolmenoid cist, porthole cist, menhirs, and rocket caves. Many of these burial sites are distributed along the entire peninsular India. We have more evidence for burial sites rather than the habitation sites. In addition to that, we find a lot of iron implements, mainly weapons of offense as well as domestic objects in these burials. The economy of the Megalithic people was mainly based on agriculture and also pastoralism, that is animal breeding. We have evidence for the coexistence of Microlithic using hunter-gatherers along with the Megalithic population. The important Megalithic sites are Mahurjari, Adichanallur, and Kodumanal. These sites have produced a lot of evidence for human skeletons. Okay, what you see in this image is from the sites of Vidarbha, which is in Maharashtra. We have poor skeletal preservation at these sites because of the pressure of burial filling. And also we get evidence for several secondary burials, and some of the bones depict burning in flush-on condition, indicating that cremation was practiced by these people. What you see in this image is a cist burial in Kodumanal in Tamil Nadu. This dates to the Iron Age or early historic period. What you have here is a stone slab built burial with three chambers. Inside these chambers, sometime we find objects as well as skeletal materials. On the right side, you see two skeletons placed by the side. Early historic and medieval historical contexts also have produced a lot of burial evidence, and they are not as much as those found in the Iron Age or from the Harappan context. Generally, the early historic as well as medieval historic period is dated between 200 to 1600 CE. The early historic period witnessed the second urbanization, and well-organized township came up in this period, and there is evidence for well-marked craft specialization. Cremation has become a more accepted mode for disposing the dead. The burial custom remained to a few ethnic groups, especially localized groups or the so-called tribes. The important sites that have produced evidence for burials are Sanjan, Roopkund, Josma, Kumhar Thekri, Arikamedu, Padri, Lashmi, Balupur. And what you see here is a burial from Nahaland from the site of Jatsoma. We have another important evidence for human skeletal materials from the Himalaya at the site called Roopkund, where skeletal remains roughly datable to 9th century CE have been found. These materials probably belong to a group of people who were walking around in this region. Due to some natural catastrophe, they were all buried, and their bones are found even now, and DNA studies have been undertaken on these bones. This is one important cluster related to the skeletal materials of India. What you see here in the image is a dacoma of Parsis excavated at Sanjan in western India. Actually, Parsis have a burial tradition in which they leave the body open to the nature, and the place where they leave the body is called dacoma. These sites are found in West Asia. In India also have a few sites that have evidence for this kind of practice. What Parsis believe is that the body should not be buried or not cremated. They should be left open to the nature. And such sites tell a lot about the ancient variations in burial practices, and this is one important site excavated in India. This is the view of the bones from at the same site in a dacoma. This is also excavated at the site of Sanjan. This is another skeletal collection from the site of Balupur. The excavators have reached a beautiful burial locality where you can see skeletal remains of several people. Such kind of sites give lot of information on the ancient skeletons as well as the nature of the population. The biological anthropology is an important field within archaeology. It is useful to understand several aspects of human lives and its evolution. One of the important functions is to understand the transition from hunting-gathering to agricultural stage. What really happens when a community or a group of people change their way of life from hunting-gathering into agriculture? What kind of changes are reflected on their bones? These are all studied by physical anthropology. In addition to that, several theories were proposed on the past of India. For example, we have Aryan invasion theory. These theories can be better understood if we study the skeletal materials. When we look at the human skeletal materials, we see a lot of morphological changes. What are the causes for these morphological changes? There are several factors responsible for these morphological changes. One is genetic, they are inherited. Second is climatic, the climate in which people live, a lot of influence on their morphological aspects. Then there are non-genetic factors like decreased mechanical stress, increased nutritional stress, and high infection rates. These factors are induced by culture-related aspects. Craniofacial morphological changes during the agricultural transition. What happens when a community changes their way of life from hunting-gathering to agriculture? These changes you can see in this image. What happens in the pre-agricultural phase? What happens in the agricultural phase? You can see the profile of the cranium, the shape of the head, the changes when there is a change in the occupation from pre-agricultural to agricultural phase. What are the changes? The changes observable are progressive decrease in cranial and postcranial robusticity. There is a diminution of the size of the human being. Robust indicates the huge individuals. And when this agricultural sets in, generally there is a decrease in the size of the stature, and we have reduced sexual dimorphism, and changes also happens in the skull shape, decrease in cranial length, increase in cranial height, and rotation of the facial region to a position more inferior to the cranium. These features you can see in this image. So we see changes in the subsistence mode from hunting gathering to agriculture affecting the various facets of life. What happens here is that generally there is a change in lifestyle. Similarly, there is change in food habits, then change in work demand on body, and also reduced muscle activity and alternate pattern of growth is seen because of the change in lifestyle. And also this results in cranial and postcranial gracility, weakly developed supraorbital ridges, smaller occiput, short stature, straight forehead, brachycrany, increased cranial height. These are some of the changes reflected on the body. And change in work demand on the masticatory apparatus. This is because of the less demand on the jaw to chew the food. What happens is, because of the development of agriculture, the food is processed more. As a result, there is less stress on the masticatory apparatus. Also, what happens is, because of the changes in the way of life, people also start consuming poor quality proteins, which also affects the overall appearance of the human beings. Again, because of the changes in the subsistence, we also see a number of other aspects like change in the settlement patterns, the settlement way the settlements are located, that also changes, and the food habits also changes, and population mobility comes down. Especially in the Mesolithic period, people were more mobile, and from the Neolithic period onwards, people were less mobile. That means people were not moving across. It is said during the Mesolithic period, people were walking at least 10 kilometers a day. So this mobility increases. In addition to that, because of the higher productivity of food, population density increases, and it leads to a lot of environmental constraints, and the resources are limited. So this in turn affects the overall life way, and people start getting poor quality food, and a lot of other chain reactions happens, and it indirectly affects the overall health as well as the physical aspects of the people. That is what you see in this particular slide. So students, so far we have seen how biological anthropology has helped us to understand the history of human health skeletal materials in India. We have the earliest evidence for human skeletal materials from Hathnora in Narmada, and in Sri Lanka we have several cave sites that have produced evidence for Mesolithic population, and again in the Neolithic context and also in Chalcolithic context we have skeletal materials from different parts of India. And the Harappan culture has produced a lot of skeletal materials and a lot of skeletons, and they help us to better understand the way of life of the people. And coming to the Megalithic or Iron Age society, we have more skeletal remains. They also tell a lot about the belief system as well as their appearance and other aspect of the people. Then in the early historic as well as medieval context also we have skeletal materials, especially those related to Parsis excavated in Western India. They are also important. They tell a lot more about the variation in burial practices. In addition to that, we also saw how transition from hunting-gathering to agro-pastoral way of life affected the human beings, their physical appearances, how the cranial profile changed because of the changed occupation as well as changed food habits. So far, we have seen the application of biological anthropology for understanding the various aspects of human life and its manifestation. Now, we will look into its use in other areas also. And we have this Aryan invasion theory proposed by many scholars earlier. Now, biological anthropology has some insight on this particular theory. So, this is the map of India showing the location of Indus Valley or Harappan cultural sites. The arrow indicates the movement of Aryans according to the views of earlier researchers. Aryan invasion theory seeks supports from the following archaeological assumptions. One is absence of horse in the Harappan sites. Identification of horse bones from Surkotada and Kalibangan has created some contrary views. However, there are technical problems in distinguishing horse from the donkey and other species. And the next issue is absence of iron in Indus civilization. Scholars interpreted the term IS as referring to iron metal. However, there are also debates that whether it really meant metal, whether it was a general term for metal, or it specifically referred to iron. So it's not again clear. After the Indus Valley civilization, we see some shift in population. Generally, it is believed that cultural degradation caused the decline of Harappan culture, not the invasion of any people. There are also claims based on the skeletal evidence from Mohenjo-daro that there was a massacre event at Mohenjo-daro, but there is no evidence from paleoanthropological context. We have no paleopathological evidence for this, and also foreign phenotypic element at Harappa and Mohenjo-daro was reported, but dental data suggests relatively genetic homogeneity of the Indus people. Cranial morphometric variations are within the accepted range of urban style of settlement. Another view was Harappan culture belonged to Dravidians, but there is no anthropological support for this hypothesis. The dental data actually indicates affinity of the Indus people with modern Dravidian, Austroasiatic and Indo-European. So what we see here is sort of a multiple ethnic assemblage. So Indus may have been composed of a multilinguistic and possibly ethnically diverse population consistent with people commonly found in large cosmopolitan areas. There have been unsuccessful attempt to decipher the Indus script, and it is also said that the Indo-Aryan speakers diffused in all directions in northern India. The expansion of Indo-Aryan speakers to the Gangetic Valley might have resulted in large-scale presence of indigenous people of north to further and further south. We have proved that people all over India have common genetic traits and origins. All Indians have the same DNA structure. No foreign genes or DNA has entered the Indian mainstream in the last 60,000 years. Paleopathology is another important branch of biological anthropology. this can tell a lot about ancient diseases. So there are several diseases that can be studied using biological material. We can study the infectious diseases caused by invading living organisms such as virus and bacteria, traumatic lesions caused by injury or malformation of the skeleton and associated soft tissues, and joint diseases can also be studied. These are the diseases that affect the joints of the body and their associated soft tissues. Then there are metabolic diseases which can also be identified by biological anthropology. These diseases are caused by a disturbance in the normal process of cell metabolisms. Stress factors, they can also be studied. They are the indicators of repetitive use of one part of the body resulting in bone remolding. Neoplastic, new bone formations can also be studied. Malignant or progressive growth which invades and destroys surrounding tissues and spread to more distant sites in the body beneath the skin can also be studied. In addition, dental diseases with anomalies such as caries, periodontal infection, attrition, tartar accumulation, antemortem tooth loss and enamel defects can also be studied using biological anthropology. Again, certain postures can also affect the bones, which can be studied using biological anthropology. Squatting actually leads to stress in certain parts of bones. Certain occupations like pottery making, where people squat and then make pottery, causes stress to the bones. These kind of occupational stresses can also be studied. Human skeletal materials from the Harappan sites give different insight. Earlier, there were interpretations that the Harappans were a very peaceful people, but a recent study by Gwen Robbins and other scholars have indicated there are cases where evidence for interpersonal violence has been found in the Harappan skeletons. These are the evidence that you see in this particular slide. Again, we have evidence for the infection and diseases and other cases from the bones that you can see in these slides. Maxillary sinusitis is another kind of abnormal condition that can be also studied using these skeletal materials. Evidence for this particular aspect has been found in several sites in India. Again, we have an interesting case of evidence related to ancient leprosy at the site of Balatal in Rajasthan. So such kind of diseases can also be studied using skeletal biology. Evidence related to urban migration can also be studied. Studies based on lead strontium isotope mortuary analysis have helped to understand the pattern of migration to the Harappan sites of Fermanagh and other Harappan sites. So ancient DNA extraction, which can be also useful in several cases at the sites of Roopkund, Sanjan and Kottapuram and Harirajpur, ancient DNA has been extracted from the human skeletal remains. This is a very developing field in biological anthropology. The application of this field might help a great deal in future. Study of ancient literature can also supplement the study of biological material. We have lot of information in Vedic literature, Samhitas, Ayurveda and Puranas, and also vernacular literature that can help us to understand the ancient life and their way of life. This is a website of adimanav.org where you can find lot of additional information related to human skeletal biology. So in this model, we saw the application of biological anthropology, how it can be useful to understand the past way of life. We looked at the evidence for human skeletal materials found in India as well as in Sri Lanka, And also we looked at the materials right from the prehistoric period and those from the Harappan context and Neolithic, Chalcolithic context, and also from the Iron Age megalithic and historical context from India. Then also we saw how Indo-Aryan migration theory can be studied in relation to the biological materials, how biological materials give much different perspective of the ground reality rather than the theories that were proposed just on the basis of armchair thinking. So the biological materials give us a better understanding of the ground reality. In addition, we saw that how this biological materials can help us to understand the occupational stresses as well as earlier diseases and their growth, and how the transition from food gathering to food producing affects the physical aspect of people. So we saw all these aspects in this particular module. I hope you understood these concepts. If you have any queries or doubts, you can refer back to the e-text, which can help you to solve your problems or any of the misunderstanding. Thank you.